So, Lisa and I grew up in the same town. We're kids. Berkeley, California. And at the time that Lisa and I were growing up, there was a very particular sort of like music scene and like musical culture that we were heavily influenced by. I can speak for myself, but Lisa, can you talk more about like your early memories of wanting to make music and what that meant for you?
Yeah, it was, I mean, I don't know about you, but it was a pretty big rap and hip-hop scene. It was kind of before the whole hyphy movement. The Bay Area was on the map, but not in a national way. You had a really kind of like, everyone was super into the regionalism in specific areas of the Bay, but it wasn't like, the Bay Area was a known popular music scene.
Yeah.
It was mostly like an underground culture. And in high school, I kind of lucked out and got this job at this venerable soul food spot called Low Supply Cooking, which was like a hub for all these Bay Area rappers. So everybody from E40 to Mac Mall to all these kind of local legends who nobody knew at the time came in, and I was producing terrible music at the time, but just mostly rap and hip hop, and that's kind of what I came up on, was a lot of that in high school. And yeah, and then after that, in subsequent years, tons of artists have like emerged from the Bay, and it's not just hip hop. And I followed Ramona.
Los Angeles.
You came to LA before me.
I was a little bit earlier.
Yeah.
Trailblazer. The Bay and LA have been a and not so much as more actually.
A rivalry.
But there was a rivalry in the past for sure.
It was just Bay people hating on LA.
Because we were so provincial. We still are.
Nobody in LA cares about.
So when do you feel like you got your first big break in the sense that you felt like it is the time that I'm moving to LA?
I mean, there wasn't any like big break moment for me. In fact, I had a lot of moments that I thought were gonna be my big break and like big opportunities that never really amounted to anything. It's weird in my career personally, like I've noticed a trend of like essentially pursuing your own specific dream or being part of other people's dream. And my brother, I went to LA, my brother ended up getting on Saturday Night Live with his two best friends, and they started this group, The Long Island. They did a bunch of digital shorts. And I did the music for them for years, and I'm thinking, like, how is this gonna pop me on? But I was still pretty broke for all of those years. And even things that did really well, you know, in just culturally, didn't really amount to anything. And I think it was kind of just starting my own band that proved to be more, just that pushed my career forward in a certain way. It was like I was viewed as a certain thing the minute I started doing my own thing versus being part of something else.
And that like includes different
box includes all members. That's a perfect example. Like I did it, and I'm like, okay, let's face it, it's out of fucking money. It was like zero money, and on Christmas, my brother, it ended up getting nominated for an Emmy, and I don't even think the show knew I did it, because NBC was, everything was kind of in-house, and they had a resident composer, and so they thought that this woman named Patrice Barnes, who's amazing, she actually just passed away from what's going on, but they thought she did it, and then they had to do the credits for it, and they're like, oh shit, this kid did it, he's like the younger brother, whatever. And my brother was a writer on the show at the time, and they never paid me, and then on Christmas my brother felt bad, so he was like, hey man, and he like pulled me into the room and gave me three $20 bills, and I was like, I'll buy a shirt. But that's often, that's been my experience. It's like, it's a trip. It's like there's so many times along the way that I thought I was gonna get paid out or this was gonna, and they all opened little doors, you know, along the way. But it was more of a slow burn than these kind of big monumental moments for me.
And so when you started, when you realized that you had to start doing your own expression, your own vision, can you talk about how that began and what kind of, I mean, speaking from experience, my own project didn't just like come out of nowhere. I was thinking about genre blending and concepts and what kind of artist I would be. And I try to impart this onto my students that you really have to know yourself and know what kind of unique vision you're bringing to the table. So what was your idea with Let Your Guest?
I've had mentors along the way. Like when I was in college, I used to call my brother and play him all my terrible music over the phone. And one day he was like, my friend on, he does music. And he put this kid on who turned out to be Danger Mouse, who's ended up being this big producer. He was one half of Gnarled Barkley, and he's become this big kind of American producer. But at the time, he was before he did Gorillaz or Black Keys or any of the students, he kind of went on to do it. He was like, I played my terrible song over the phone, and he was like, oh, that's cool, and you should continue sending stuff. And I lived in Seattle at the time, and so I ended up kind of moving into his old house and doing all this stuff. But I never wanted to be in a band person. I always had vision for songs, but I would just kind of sing reference vocals over my own music. And at a certain point, he kind of sang it, kind of pulled me aside and was like, oh, you should do an album with you singing. And I was like, oh, okay. And then we kind of ended up doing our first album together. We co-produced it. And it was just kind of, it wasn't like, I didn't really think out the vision so much. It was more just like what I was making at the time. And it ended up being kind of like poppy, you know, with some nostalgia from, you know, I don't know, 70s, 80s stuff. But just like any good life, you kind of step into yourself more clearly with each year. And I think it's actually taken me years to hone in on you know, what I want to do and what my vision is. It's kind of like, if you do music over the years, it's like looking at a picture of yourself. Somebody snaps a picture of you 7 years ago, and you could look back and go, oh my God, that outfit was terrible. You know, like, but that's who you were, that was the incarnation you were at that moment, and you know, your style switches up and all that. But I totally agree that having a vision is crucial, because a lot of people now are just following trends, and I think that's how you fall off. The more you're chasing, this is popular right now, I'll do some you know, kind of trendy thing. I think that that's how you're always behind the curve. The more you do you and you truly step into what you like, because all you have is that feeling, like walking away from something, like, oh, I love how that sounds, or whatever. That's kind of all you have. As much as there are people who will tell you, like, they can pick a hit or pick a trend, I realize it's kind of, if there was people like that, they'd be just printing money.
Right,
exactly.
You
know
they fuck around. Yeah, it is, a lot of it is, it's a lot of chance and feeling for certain. I want to talk about the single off of the album that you made with Jason Oz. So it's kind of old. So, you know, you're talking about it being kind of nostalgic or retro, so that's definitely felt in the production, right?
Yeah.
It has this kind of like girl group, like Supremes thing going on, which is funny because that was like one of the things I was thinking about when I was first talking about it. Remember writing about Wilkins and that sound. And Danger Mouse was very much a part of that. But then what's really interesting about the song is that, well, it's a really big song, right?
Yeah.
We'll listen to it in a second, but let's explain it first. But what's interesting is you say that you can think of yourself as a singer, but what's very distinct about the song are the vocals, being in falsetto. So can you just talk about why?
Well, it's funny you said that, because I wrote for a girl. Like,
okay.
That was like, I didn't write it for myself. It was before I had ever considered doing my own thing. So those were just reference vocals that I thought a girl was in. And yeah, I was really into like the kind of Motown era thing. But as I've grown, I never trying to emulate something on the nose retro. I think like Motown was done, they killed it. I'm never gonna fucking top that. And I always think it's kind of boring. You always want to have some new aspect to it, whether or not I succeeded in that story. But yeah, I think the production was, I had no idea what I was doing at all. I was just like listening to a ton of Motown, and we had this big pink, like Pepto-Bismol pink grand piano that someone left in this house that I was living in. I moved into Danger Mouse's house, and it was kind of this revolving door of tons of LA bands. weird kids. There was a studio in the basement. People were there day and night, and I was just meeting. And I just kind of tinkered out that little piano part at the beginning of the song. And when I played it for Brian Dangerhouse, months later, he was like, oh, that's, you gotta sing that. He was like, it's great with, you know, my kind of weird, insecure falsetto at the time. But yeah, it made it. It added something unique to it.
So I'm gonna play really quick, and then maybe we can talk about the structure of it slightly. Yeah. You can talk about how you wrote it. So let's just listen. Intuitively, but it wasn't something at the time. I think I'm a little more cognizant of it now, of how to build a song and all the points to hit. But at the time, it really wasn't too skillful. It was more just like, oh, those chords were, you know, like, sadly. And yeah, I mean, it's funny too, because it still has proven to be like a popular song for us. But nobody can really sing along with it. It's like, at shows, people always kind of, So, I mean, I even listening to it, I would change that, you know, but yeah, I think I came in, like, the demo was pretty much there, and I think the first day that I stepped into the studio with Dangerhouse, was not the first time I was in a legit studio. And it was the first song he wanted to work on because I think he thought it could be something, so he wanted to put his hands on it. And we kind of, I remember the one thing we added, he was like, it's pretty much there, but let's just add a clap, that clap, in the pre-chorus.
Get back, open, get high.
That little part. And then into the chorus, we added this one effect of vocals. And then you kind of like, it's good, it's what it is. And we changed the lyric, actually the drum fill beginning. That was an actual Motown sample. And he was like, we don't want to pay for that, so we kind of replaced that with the snare, which I always hated the sound. It was never as good as the sample, but yeah, I mean, it ended up, strangely, it's funny, now I do intellectualize the process, and I can tell you exactly why I think something does this or that musically. That being said, there's a wisdom that all of us have, not knowing shit about music, that you sit down and things just come out, and that you don't over-intellectualize the process. And there, I've actually found myself, even on my second album, the minute that you do something that pops off and people tell you that's good, you start thinking like, damn, I think I know a thing or two. And you can actually get in your head in a way that isn't helpful. So I'm now trying to get back to the place that I was before, just trying to play in the studio, kind of like, oh, this sounds good without overthinking stuff. So it's always a balance. I'm not at all saying don't know your history, you know what I mean? Because I think actually what if anything, what music lacks today is that people don't know. They don't know all the rules about music. And so I work with a lot of people now, big, big songwriters that have a lot of hits under their belt that tell me all the time, yeah, I wrote this song, it popped off, it broke this record and that record, but it doesn't stay, it doesn't have the staying power of like an Amy Winehouse song or a Lauryn Hill song. Like, why is that? And I think that actually is because people don't have the craft and the chops that they necessarily used to. I think it's like, you write on whatever's easiest. So back in the day, it was a piano, a guitar, and now it's a laptop, which is all good. There's nothing wrong with that. But if there is something to diving in and knowing. I'm saying kind of contradictory things now. It's like, oh, your intuition is wisdom, and da da da. And yeah, it's also good to know your history.
It's paradoxical, songwriting.
Yeah, totally. And it's like wherever you're at, you know, like you go off like what your vibe is at that particular moment. But yeah, this particular one had no, you know, no learned skill. It was just kind of like I was kind of going off where I was at the
time. Were you thinking more like melodically and less lyrically, like where you kind of just like.
Yeah, totally.
I always do that.
I always kind of riff a melody, and then at the time for years, and I still do this. Sometimes whatever you mumble syllabically, it's so intuitive. You're not thinking at all. You're just like mumbling that you actually end up like saying words that are kind of like in the vibe of the song, and that like it was initially it was like I'm on fire. And then it was like, and then we changed it to I go higher or whatever. But that was the little lyric that I remember. But a lot of times I ended up when you try to write like heightened lyrics over stuff, it clashes. It's like, oh, this doesn't have like it doesn't flow the way that ooh that I said naturally in the demo was. And so I tried to kind of like match syllabically in my early years a lot of things because there was just a flow to the demos that sometimes I couldn't capture when I tried to write. Lyrics. So a lot of this stuff was just like trying to match the mumbles that I had. Mm-hmm.
Super catchy melody, super groovy. And so, if I might extend from what you said, I would say that the core of the song is invalidated groove, right? So it's
totally.
Not as much about the lyrics, right?
Yeah, totally.
It's like, but that doesn't mean that every song that we write isn't about lyrics. It just means that that's the core of the song, how it speaks.
Totally.
Through that melody, that top line, that like falsettos and catchy top line, the anxious retention it has. It's not feels tense the whole time.
Yeah, yeah,
you're like
yeah.
waiting for it to sort of like explode.
Yeah.
You know? And so it seems like from your first album to your second album, there was a lot of time that you were building on this album. Were you touring a lot? Were you writing for other people? Were you writing for yourself? What was going on?
No, the same thing that I was describing earlier, like that you get in your head and you destroy yourself. That's what happened to me. I wasted 5 years of my life being like, oh my God, like I hate the first album. That song's so annoying. I must prove to the world I'm different. So I basically wasted 5 years like writing like some avant-garde pop album that then I turned into label and I was like, okay, go. and then I had to write a whole new album, which I did. But yeah, like.
Can you talk about that a little bit more? What that means to turn in that album to a label and for them to say no?
Yeah, it was crushing. It was, you know, it's. I remember reading this article with Andre 3000 back in the day before he released. They released the double Outkast album that had Andre's half and Big Boy's half that had the Hey Ya, which is probably maybe one of the biggest global songs since like Nirvana, Smells Like Teen Spirit, like massive cross-genre rock rock song. But he said, he was like, when we released that, like we were a hip hop group and he gave it out to all these hip hop publications and they loved Big Boy's side, but they literally didn't understand and actively disliked my side of the fucking thing. Like, you're kind of like, he was singing like musicals on there, and then Hey Ya, which was this acoustic thing. And he said, like 7 days before release it, I was going to scrap the album and never release it. And then they went on to win Album of the Year. It was like this monumental thing. So I always kept that in my head. Like, you never know what something is until you release it. And that's like a good thing and a bad thing. But like, a lot of times you'll write something that you love and you put it out, like, it's garbage. And like, oh God, no, I. But yeah, I put out this album, and a lot of it was like, it was co-shaped by Danger Mouse. He's a super creative dude, and he kind of put, and the album ended up being this kind of indie pop thing, and I really wanted it to be more R&B and have some of the hip hop roots that we came from in the Bay. And he was super anti that. He just doesn't really like R&B, and he has a ton of rules that I kind of followed, but yeah, so I ended up doing this second album, and it just, I wasted like 3 years doing it, and then I turned into the label, and they were like, yeah, it's just not good, you know? So it was kind of like back to the drawing board, and I tried to basically get back into the whole, like, that same article, Andre 3000, he said, he said that, like, they just, when they were making the double album, they would go into the studio, and they'd call it, like, crib or something, and they were like, we pretend that we were just kids, like try not to judge the song, and just try to have it come out, and whatever comes out, like just go with it, because you can really kill something before you even know what it is. You start like, it's a splitter, fuck all that, just try to like write, have fun, and then after you put some real work in, then you can step back.
Sophomore album is the most difficult album to make. Totally. You have the judgment, you know,
totally.
Not negative judgment, but any judgment. So in 2017 was your sophomore album. Plural.
Yeah.
And so I was thinking about playing a double from that record because it's very different from this song. But it's super catchy, great song. And it has that falsetto.
Yeah. I like it too. Like I don't look back in cringe.
So you made this album for a pop album. The label wasn't having it. It's probably fantastic, and labels are stupid. But you made this album.
That's pretty bad. I listened to it. You're right.
So you have this record, Plural, and you have one of the singles, but Double. So can you talk about where you were at when you were making this song, for instance, like the Sleepy Grand?
Yeah, well, so I wrote the Problem on Guard album. And they didn't like it. And then I was like, you know what? Whatever I've been doing with my heady process, I'm gonna scrap that and try to just have fun. And so really it was like, I linked with your dude, who's a producer, and he produced some stuff on that album. And it was kind of like, the goal here is to just try to get back to having fun while writing music. And I had spent some time in Mexico, and just some themes came up for me, and yeah, I it was kind of just getting back to this, trying to get back to the same place that I had with this head of old time.
Mm-hmm.
Just kind of, and all my stuff is pretty groove oriented over lyrics. I mean, I struggle with lyrics, I'm not good at them. If I have a lot of time, I can write some okay lyrics, but yeah, this was the same thing. Starts with a groove, started with piano, add drums, and kind of go from there.
Sorry, Trina,
for one. Came up just to move, pull my back, put on the show. It's my thing, oh baby, girl, there's a need. And we'll come and I'm lucky.
And you saw that, and it's interesting that the demo is not very different.
No, it just has the kind of those drums that
were added. More high five.
Yeah, totally.
But you were able to sense from hearing that in that moment, and being a genuine seeing that, you were able to sort of intuitively know that this was.
Yeah, I thought we had something. It's rare that you write, like, oh, this might be something, but it was, I thought it was something.
So then, in a way, this was a moment where you were right about it. You know, because you've been talking about how sometimes you think it's going to be a big time in your career, but it's actually about building.
Yeah, yeah.
But this was a moment where your intuition about it being there was actually.
Yeah, sure. I guess I did think it could be something.
And so you received a lot of accolades for this, obviously. Grammy.
I was an idiot with this stuff.
Why?
Because this was pretty much my first time, you know, writing for other people. And I was like, I just was like, because of the change of the drums, I wanted, like, first I wanted to be more like a Drake song. You know, I just had that kick. And when the drum got on, I was like, oh, this shit changed. And I was like, don't put my name on it. Oh, yeah, totally. So, total idiot. And then my friend John, who's singing the song, was like, please, you are a fool. Like, you know, like, put your name on it. I didn't get credited for it, like, for my voice on it. Because I'm singing all the background and stuff. And And it did, you know, it did do well. It did win a Grammy and all that stuff, but I didn't win anything because it won for best pop performance, and you have to be performing on the song.
I had no idea.
To get the thing. So it was like, you know, like, but it was my first, it was not my first producing for other people. It was like my first thing. So I learned a lot.
And you've gone on to produce it, like, for a lot of incredible people. Carly Rae Jepsen, Anime, a bunch of others. Now you're going to start working with Mitchell Kirk, or EGR, I don't like to say the name.
Yeah.
But, so, this is really open a lot of doors for doing something that you may not be like, I don't want my name on it. You might create something where you're like, I'm not the future.
Totally. Right. Also, you learn, too, that, like, it's not your song. Like, you know, I think that was my problem. I was like, this is like, you get so attached to it, and I sat with it for a year. And then the same thing, the label was kind of like, we kind of want to take this to a bigger producer, you know, John Hill, the initial guy that I met. And he did his thing on it. I think in retrospect, all his choices were great and were totally right on. And at the time, I kind of was just like naive and just was like so attached to it, I couldn't really see it. And really, the job as a producer is it isn't your song, you're supposed to do whatever the band wants, so.
Well, so you've gone on now to release your third album, which just came out, Kim, and so you've been touring. He just got in last night, and he so graciously arrived today to speak to you all. And we're going to, like, break your questions in a little bit, but I want to play one more song from your new album. So is being the more song?
Yeah.
Okay. But so can you talk about where you were at?
This kind of, that started to make me seem like one note, because it's like the same damn thing. It's like very Motown, throwback.
Sorry, should I have done more?
No, it's fine.
You can pick any song you want from this. I just kind of I was drawn to this one.
Yeah, so, it's the same thing. It's kind of like a modern take on like the, a little bit of like a doo-wop, throwback, Motown thing.
Okay, let's play it.
We're gonna get rocking. All right, so, yeah, wish you luck.
See you at the top.
And so we're here we go.
Oh.
song to me is that this has like all of the elements of the past two songs, but the big difference is that it has that chorus and like the
totally
chorus.
So this follows a lot of like Songwriting 101.
Can you talk about that?
Yeah, like well, this was a song where like the label kind of got involved actually.
Oh yeah. Shit.
They had told me, but I did Feel It Still. I signed with Atlantic pretty much because of Feel It Still. Like, they showed interest in me after that, and then they signed my group. And they were like, oh, if Craig, like the head dude, if he gets involved, if he gets you notes, it's like, take him. Because that's like a good thing, and they'll get behind it. And Craig was like, all right, it's a note. So I was really interested. And his notes were all great. They were more like the classic things, like at the end. He was like, add a second. You like add an alternate melody at the end, you know, so it's like, I'm in this hell and I'm in. There's this kind of like, and then I'm kind of freestyling over that. And then he was like add a lead, kind of like the Cure, like an 80s like melody there. So there's this guitar part, which you're not. But it was more just like builds and falls of the song that really kind of like just you transition to each part.
So that in my opinion, so that you hear the chords multiple times and your ears turn tighter.
Totally.
Keep wanting to hear
new information. Yeah.
Yeah. And so the beat is interesting because there's those like super sub kicks.
Yeah.
Which give it that like mega hip hop feel. Like it's not you're just like hinting at it, you're like, this is a blend of hip hop.
Yeah, totally.
Okay.
Totally.
So
we added live drums to it and it didn't really work. They're tucked in there, but you can't, yeah.
I like the production palette there. You have to modernize the Motown sound, right? You can't just like have them hand instrument.
Yeah.
It's hard to pull it off.
Cool.
So it's an interesting, it's really interesting to watch your trajectory for these albums, and especially with Build Still as well, because that is, it's such an electric guess on the way, you know? Even though I am
right,
and everything, but still there's elements of the line. Your music, so